The Russian T-34 tank was probably the greatest tank of World War II. Produced in huge numbers in a remote site in Siberia, known as Tankograd, the T-34 was reliable in all weathers, was the only tank that could stand up to the mighty German panzers, and fought in some of the greatest tank battles in history on the Eastern Front.
The T-34 was very agile, and it was very fast.
And it was the T-34 that led the Red Army in its advance to Berlin, the capital of Hitler's Reich, and to final victory. Using authentic archive film and color reconstructions, Battle Stations goes right inside the dangerous, frightening world of the T-34 tank and its crew.
If I said I wasn't scared, it would be untrue. All of us were very scared.
In the 1930s, the Soviet Union was a vast country of 180 million people, extending from the edge of Europe to farthest East Asia. Its land borders ran for more than 12,000 miles. But its defense was primitive. As the country tried to catch up, it industrialized as quickly as it could. To make up for its lack of resources, its armed forces simply copied military technology from the West. Because of the vast distances, tanks were a priority. And the Soviets soon became aware of maverick American tank designer J. Walter Christie.
J. Walter Christie was a genius of the First Order. The fastest tanks that had ever been made up to that date were Christie designs. One of the things that he does come up with is a system by which each one of the road wheels is independently sprung. And because of this, his tanks are extraordinarily fast for the period.
The Russians acquired some of Christie's tank designs. The US military, however, ultimately rejected Christie's work.
Mr. Christie's ideas were not adopted by the United States Army because of the not invented here syndrome. The Army did not invent his ideas. The Soviets were quite eager to borrow any good idea that they could get. They have a vast country to defend. It didn't bother them if they didn't invent it there.
But this was the era of Stalin's great purges. Two-thirds of party leaders, scientists, doctors, and peasants were denounced as enemies of the people and executed. Then, the terror spread to the Soviet army.
In June 1937, Stalin arrested 8 of his army's most senior officers and accused them of treason. Eventually, about half the senior officers in the whole army were arrested. Some of them were simply shot, others disappeared into labor camps in Siberia. It was a quite extraordinary episode, and it left the Red Army weakened and disorganized.
One of the victims of Stalin's purges was Afanasy Firtsov, the head of the Tank Design Bureau, working on plans for a new Soviet tank. He was sent to a hard labor camp in Siberia, where he later died.
My father used to say to me that they owed a lot to Firtsov, because they were just young boys, fresh from university.
Replacing Firtsov, the brilliant young engineer Mikhail Koshkin took over the design of the new tank.
Mikhail Koshkin, according to the memories of those who knew him well, was a very passionate man. He fell in love with the tank immediately. He fell in love with the idea.
Koshkin incorporated the best of different elements of foreign tank design. In 1939, he took the plans for the new tank to Moscow.
He took the blueprints, the drawings, and the models to Moscow, to the session of the Supreme Military Council. Stalin spoke and said, "I would like to go back to the idea of the new tank. I think Koshkin and the designers should be given a chance. If they succeed, we will get a new, unique tank. If they fail, we shall punish them.
In this climate of fear and secrecy, Koshkin and his team were allowed to carry on with their work. Koshkin concentrated on simplicity, guns, armor, and mobility. In the spring of 1940, Hitler launched his blitzkrieg attack on France, Belgium, and Holland. His lightning victory in the West proved to everyone the primacy of the tank in modern war by leading a fast-moving attack and in destabilizing the enemy. Although the Soviets were allies of the Germans at this time, they knew it was an uneasy alliance. Most Soviet armor was no match for the panzers that had so brilliantly led the invasion of France. Only the new tank, still under development in great secrecy, could hope to stand up to the German panzers. But Mikhail Koshkin never lived to see his tank fight in action. He caught pneumonia during trials and died in September 1940. But his tank, now officially numbered the T-34, was almost complete. By comparison to Western tanks, it was very basic. Russia was not a mechanized country, and the peasants and factory workers who crewed the T-34 did not expect luxuries.
The interior of the tank was like a luxury hotel.
It was a beautiful vehicle, a joy to look at. My first impression was excellent.
The crew had to work together in close quarters.
The tank commander and the gunner were both in the turret. The driver and I, the machine gunner, were sitting side by side in the front of the tank.
The driver wrestled with the controls, which were physically very demanding.
We had steering levers on the right and the left. If I needed to go right, I pulled the left lever. If I needed to go left, I pulled the right lever. There were pedals, an accelerator pedal like in a car, and a clutch pedal.
The T-34 was heavy going, and there were no automatic controls in those days. But once you got to know it, you learned to change gears. You felt the engine working, and you got to change gears smoothly.
Commanders often communicated with drivers by touch.
Forward, to drive forward, the sign was to push him in the back. If you need to turn left or right, you nudged him with your leg. Even if you touched him very lightly, he knew exactly what to do.
Stop, forwards, right, left.
But the key to the T-34's success would prove to be its armor, nearly 2 inches thick and sloping, and its main gun. The first models fired a powerful 76mm. Later tanks were equipped with an even more deadly 85mm weapon.
The T-34 has some really good strong points, one of which is the gun. The armor was superb. The armor, this vehicle was the first vehicle to ever to have sloped armor, which is miles ahead of flat-faced armor. The other thing about it was it had a diesel engine, which did not burn if the vehicle got hit, like a Sherman. A Sherman would burn. The T-34 did not burn as easily. It has wide track. It allowed the vehicle to have good mobility in ice, snow, and mud.
In the spring of 1941, Hitler began to amass his armies along the long 450-mile border with the Soviet Union. Stalin ignored all warnings, convinced that Hitler would not invade. But by midsummer, Hitler had assembled the biggest invasion force in history. How could the Red Army, fatally weakened by Stalin's purges, resist such a force? 22nd of June, 1941. Hitler unleashes Operation Barbarossa. 7,000 field guns. 3 million German troops supported by 1 million other Axis soldiers. 3,350 tanks launch a vast offensive against the Soviet Union. The Red Army stood no chance. Their most numerous tanks, the T-26 and T-28, were poorly armored and undergunned and proved no match for the battle-hardened panzers. The Russian losses were immense. Hundreds of square miles of territory were occupied. The Germans continued to drive towards the major Russian cities. 600,000 Russians were taken prisoner. Nearly 6,000 tanks were destroyed or captured. Hitler spoke of his crusade against communism. He called the Soviet state a rotten structure that, when kicked in, would come crashing down. It looked as though he would be proved right. In August, the German army reached the giant, open prairie fields of the Ukraine. Now it seemed unstoppable. On the 21st of September, the Germans captured Kiev, along with 250,000 Soviet prisoners. Hitler called it the greatest battle in world history. But with massively extended supply lines, even the German army could not keep up this momentum. And then, as before in history, the Russian winter came to the aid of the defenders. The first snow fell in early September, and although it soon melted, it turned roads into rivers of mud. Hitler's advanced troops were only a few miles from Moscow when the freezing winter blizzards set in.
No one lost faith. No one thought the Germans would win. The talk was that in Napoleon's time, the French reached Moscow but then froze to death. I certainly never imagined that we would lose the war. It never crossed my mind. I never heard my comrades say anything of the kind.
Despite the bitter cold, the Germans were certain that the Red Army was on the brink of total collapse. Then came a complete surprise. On the 5th of December, Stalin launched a powerful counterattack. Fresh troops from Asia, well equipped for winter fighting, threw the Germans into retreat. Moscow was saved, as was Stalin's Russia.
There's little doubt that the Germans were tantalizingly close to victory in 1941. In early December, some of them were just 17 miles from Moscow's Kremlin. But the Germans had underestimated the corrosive effects of distance and of the dreadful Russian winter. In the end, they just ran out of men.
Within the first chaotic weeks of the German invasion, the Soviets had sprung one surprise on the Germans. In July, the first T-34s were ordered into action. Developed amidst great secrecy, no Westerner had set eyes on the tank before. The German soldiers watched in astonishment as their shells bounced off the front armor of the Soviet tank. Wherever a T-34 appeared, it succeeded in holding up the advance.
When the Germans first see these vehicles, they're shocked. They can't believe that these subhumans, the Undermenschen, can have such a vehicle. It was actually superior to anything they had at that time.
Now, with their industrial base devastated, the Soviets attempted what to many seemed impossible. Entire factories were packed up and transported by train east behind the Ural Mountains. A new tank factory was built near the town of Nizhny Tagil in Siberia. Here, in appalling conditions, Soviet engineers and workers restarted production on a massive scale. Several tank men were drafted in to work temporarily in the factory.
It was a huge plant, a huge place with many workshops, with its own steelmaking and steelworking plant. People working there were tired, exhausted.
Food supplies were poor. We were issued with only 400 grams of bread per day.
There were a lot of women workers there, because most of the men had been conscripted, and they did a lot of the heavy work.
They worked day and night, 12-hour shifts. Nizhny Tagil produced, before I arrived, 40 tanks a day. And by the end, when we received our tanks, it was producing 60 tanks a day.
Despite winter temperatures that reached minus 30 degrees and a thick snow blanket for 5 months of the year, this town would eventually become the center of a huge complex of tank production, known outside Russia simply as Tankograd. But could enough tanks be produced in time to prevent the Nazis from finishing off what they had nearly completed by the winter of 1941? The war on the Eastern Front was a tank war. Huge numbers of infantry were deployed, but both sides relied on armored units to lead them across the vast distances.
Tanks operate well in open terrain. And of course, Russia is a wide open expanse, and it is great tank country.
Tank crews would work together and live together for weeks at a time. Sometimes political slogans would be daubed on the side of a tank, like "Forwards to Victory" or "Together We Defeat Fascism."
"For the Motherland." This was the slogan on my tank, painted in white.
Getting enough to eat was always a challenge.
Походная кухня.
The field kitchens cooked different soups, cabbage soup, beetroot soup, made out of whatever ingredients the cook could find.
We had canned meat. American canned meat was a particular favorite. We had enough bread? Well, what else did we need?
And of course, we could always replenish our supplies with booty.
And to supplement the rations, every Russian soldier was given an allowance of vodka.
We drank vodka from the same flask. The commander had the first go, and then passed it around the whole crew. Vodka was issued once a day, usually in the evening. We were issued with 100 milliliters each.
We were closer than brothers to each other, like one big family. There was real warmth and closeness. We worried about each other, as we did for ourselves.
In 1942, as the spring thaw arrived, fierce fighting started up once again. And in late summer, forward German troops advanced right to the banks of the Volga River and reached the city of Stalingrad. Here, one of the great battles of history unfolded. After months of intense fighting, the Red Army succeeded in cutting off the entire German Sixth Army. Surrounded, with petrol and ammunition running out, the Germans were squeezed to breaking point. On the 31st of January, 1943, what was left of the Sixth Army surrendered. 91,000 men, including 22 German generals and their commander, Field Marshal von Paulus, went into captivity.
I think that Stalingrad really was one of history's decisive battles. Although the Germans remained formidable, the battle's impact was terrific. A whole army had disappeared from the German order of battle. Her allies were dispirited and her opponents encouraged. Stalingrad ended the myth of German invincibility.
In 1943, the huge numbers of T-34s coming into service would begin to have a major impact on the course of the war. In July, the Battle of Kursk turned into the biggest tank battle of the war. Three German armies prepared to assault a Russian line some 100 miles wide.
During the Battle of Kursk, the Russians know that the Germans are going to attack them. And because they know they're going to be attacked, they adopt an offensive posture. And they, in fact, lure the Germans into fire cauldrons where they actually decimate the Germans in these ambushes, large ambushes.
The German panzer crews fought bravely, but were overwhelmed by Soviet firepower.
And then, once they do that, then they can go back over and use the tank in what it's actually best used for, in the attack.
The Soviets had six tank brigades in reserve, which were now hurled into the battle. From now on, the momentum on the Eastern Front would remain with the Red Army. As the Germans withdrew along the Eastern Front, they left a trail of devastation behind them, destroying everything in a vicious policy of scorched earth.
When the Germans were retreating, they destroyed a lot. They usually blew up railways. They destroyed the factories and plants that produced for war.
June 1944. 1,000 miles to the west, the Allies landed in France to open the Second Front. As the Allies fought their way out of the Normandy beachheads, Soviet Army Group Center launched another huge offensive on the Eastern Front. Outnumbering the Germans by 3-1, the Red Army advance picked up speed. Across the Eastern Front, Russian tank crews faced dangers almost daily. T-34 machine gunner Zufar Zadadinov's tank was ordered to clear a village in the Ukraine.
We were told that the Germans had no tanks, but only light artillery. But the information turned out to be wrong, and we were ambushed. And there were Tiger tanks.
Засада!
The commander of my tank shouted, "Ambush! Turn left!" I continued firing my machine gun because ahead of me were German infantry. And all of a sudden I could hear a terrible noise, and something heavy fell on me. It turned out that we'd been ambushed by a Tiger tank, and their shell hit us head on and came in and ricocheted around the turret. When I came to, it was hard to see much inside the tank because it was filled with smoke. But then all of a sudden, within seconds, the air cleared. I lifted my head, and I could see that the turret was full of light. And I looked down, and I saw the commander and the gunner lying on the floor.
Командир и башенный стрелок.
Руки. Руки. Мои руки.
The commander groaned, "My arms, my arms." And then I saw that both his arms were injured. I asked the driver, Nikolai, what happened, but he didn't answer. I shook him by his shoulders and saw that he was unconscious. So I tried to start the tank, the engine. I pressed the ignition switch. And it started working. That cheered me up a lot. Then I pushed the levers into the first gear and felt that the tracks were intact. I went into first, second, and I tried to go a bit faster and got into third gear. This is how I escaped.
The gunner died. The commander and the driver recovered in hospital and eventually returned to the front. Zufar Zadadinov was decorated for his heroism. By 1944, The workers in Tankograd were now producing some 2,000 tank chassis each month, far in excess of German tank production. With the Russian steamroller sweeping west, Soviet soldiers at last began to liberate Russian towns and villages.
It was such a joy to meet the people who had been under occupation. It really gave us such a boost. They threw themselves at us, kissing us and crying. And of course, anyone's heart would have melted.
In the summer of 1944, the Red Army advance reached Eastern Europe. And in September, the 6th Tank Army, led by T-34s, captured the Romanian capital, Bucharest. Here, the Russians were welcomed as heroes.
And in Romania, some were throwing flowers at us. Some were offering wine. They were all smiling, cheerful and friendly. There was a feeling of pride. Every one of us felt very proud.
January 1945, the next Soviet offensive, this time across Poland. Again, the T-34s spearhead the Red Army's progress, which reached 50 miles a day. After 6 weeks, the Red Army arrived at the border with Germany and waited. In the early spring of 1945, the Red Army prepared for its final assault on Hitler's capital, Berlin. Two complete Soviet Army groups assembled in readiness along a 100-mile front, led by Marshal Zhukov and Marshal Konev, competing to win the glory of capturing Berlin. Meanwhile, General Eisenhower, whose Allied armies had now crossed the Rhine and were advancing eastwards across Germany, decided to leave Berlin to the Russians.
Eisenhower had good reason to leave Berlin to the Russians. Firstly, in February 1945, the Allies had met at Yalta and agreed on the post-war division of Germany. The eastern part, with Berlin in it, was going to be occupied by the Russians. So it made no sense to waste British and American lives to capture something which would have to be given up after the war. Secondly, whatever the politics, Eisenhower knew very well that Berlin would be a tough nut to crack.
Monday, 16th of April, 1945. The Red Army finally launches its assault on Berlin with a mighty barrage. Storming a high ridge known as the Salov Heights on the far bank of the River Oder was the first objective.
We heard the heavy shells begin to explode. Non-stop firing. Everything was roaring. And we waited for the order to advance. It was very frightening.
This difficult military operation held up Zhukov's army group for 3 days. During the delay, Marshal Konev's army group advanced from the south into the suburbs of Berlin. F- fearful of the revenge the Soviets would unleash on Germany for the atrocities they had committed in Russia, the Germans fought with fanatical determination.
To the very last moment, they were fighting bitterly.
On every corner, from every roof, from every window, they were shooting and firing at us. It was horrific, horrific.
The Nazis had organized the old men and young boys into a people's militia, the Volkssturm. They were armed with two powerful anti-tank weapons, the handheld Panzerfaust and the Panzerschreck.
Once you get a tank inside a city, it suddenly loses all the advantages it has on open terrain. It's channeled down very narrow avenues of approach. And because the enemy knows where these tanks are going to come from, they can ambush them very easily, using, in the Germans' case, the Panzerschreck or the Panzerfaust, and knock them out very easily.
Armed with these anti-tank weapons, what was left of the German fighting machine took on the Russian tanks.
There were a lot of Panzerfausts in Berlin. They were lying in every basement. Mostly the operators were old men or boys.
Russian tank losses were severe. Overall, the Russians lost 400,000 men in the battle for Berlin. The soldiers of Marshal Zhukov and Marshal Konev had to fight for each suburb, then for each street. Finally, for each house. Parts of the city were reduced to rubble.
I had seen our Russian cities destroyed, razed to the ground. So I was not wide-eyed. Naturally, we had to destroy in our turn.
With the Germans still fighting fiercely, it was Marshal Zhukov's men who finally reached the heart of Berlin, only a few hundred yards from Hitler's underground headquarters. Knowing at last that the war was lost, Hitler committed suicide on the afternoon of Monday, the 30th of April. His SS guards dragged his body out of the bunker and set fire to it. A few days later, the Germans laid down their weapons and surrendered. Most Germans wanted to surrender to the Americans or British, fearful of reprisals from the Russians. The Russians were keen to leave their mark on Hitler's capital, but it was soon difficult to find a space on the walls of the Reichstag to carve a message.
We took turns to go to the Reichstag. And then we had to climb on each other's shoulders to be able to leave our message.
I wrote, "A boy from faraway Siberia has reached the Reichstag, Berlin."
I wrote just my name. Sergeyev.
The The war on the Eastern Front had been fought on a monumental scale. Millions of men had fought on both sides. The price of victory was immense. Tens of thousands of farms, thousands of factories, hundreds of towns, and dozens of cities had been destroyed. Latest estimates suggest that as many as 27 million Russians had been killed. The Soviet state had nearly caved in under the onslaught, as Hitler predicted. But the line held. Just. And in the vanguard of the Russian advance, 1,500 miles from Stalingrad to Berlin, went the T-34 tank, produced in huge numbers in Siberia.
The production of the T-34 tank is an extraordinary achievement for a country that is basically just industrializing. And not only is it an extraordinary achievement of just being able to do it technologically, which it's a technological marvel in and of itself, but they made in excess of 50,000 of these vehicles. Lenin once said that quantity has a quality all its own. So the Germans got outproduced in addition to being outfought.
The T-34 played a crucial role in the offensive. Without it, I doubt we would have won the war.
This was the tank whose first designer was sent by Stalin to rot in a labor camp. At last, the war in Europe was over. Now the Russian soldiers could celebrate.
Victory. Victory. I can't describe the feelings I felt at that time. We were the victors then. It was the joy of victory, firstly. And secondly, I was glad to be alive and in good health, with my limbs intact. I was very happy to have survived.
T-34 is a basic, simple vehicle. Everything about it is as simple as can be. It was made that way because you're dealing with a bunch of folks that are not mechanically adept. They may not have even driven a tractor on the collective back home. So this vehicle is designed to be maintained by folks that are not mechanically adept. The Soviets were quite eager to borrow any good idea that they could get. They have a vast country to defend, and anything that they can use that was foreign didn't bother them if they didn't invent it there. The Soviets actually see the tests that Mr. Christie does in the United States with his vehicles. There was nothing secret about these things. They appeared in the press. So either through espionage or through the Soviet military attaché actually going to Mr. Christie and buying this stuff, they got it. The main strengths of the T-34 are its armor. It had very good armor for its time. The armor was sloped, and because it was sloped, it increased the depth of the armor without increasing its weight. If you draw two lines on a piece of paper that are parallel and then slope them 60 degrees, you lengthen the armor, you double it with no increase of weight, and you get a grazing effect. And this was the first vehicle to have sloped armor, a very, very innovative thing of the period. The gun was good. The Soviets realized that the 76-millimeter gun that appeared on the first vehicle was going to become obsolete. So what they did was, when they designed this T-34-76, they made the turret ring big enough to take an 85-millimeter turret. So all they had to do was take off the 76-millimeter turret, they put on the 85-millimeter turret, and away they went. Really thinking ahead, that was a very good point. The other thing, it had very wide tracks. This allowed the vehicle to move through ice and snow and mud very well. The other thing was, of course, it had the Christie suspension system, which is a very simple sort of system. And it's almost, not quite, but almost maintenance-free. Whereas the German system, with the overlapping track on the Panther, was notorious for getting bogged down in mud and that sort of thing, and it would freeze. So the Soviets were way ahead of them in that regard. The other thing was, it had a great engine. The engine was a diesel-powered engine, and of course diesel does not burn as well as gasoline. So if the tank took a hit, the vehicle did not burn as easily as, say, a Sherman would. The really bad thing about the T-34, however, is the transmission. It has absolutely, beyond a shadow of a doubt, the worst transmission known to mankind. But the Russians knew that. So they hinged the back of the vehicle so that they could very easily change the transmission. In the T-34-76, one of the things about the turret, it does not have a cage on the inside. So when the turret turns, the crew actually has to walk around inside the vehicle. It's very hard because you have shell casings in the bottom of the vehicle, you have ammunition cans in the bottom of the vehicle. Just the smoke and confusion of battle makes this very difficult to do. The other thing is, when the gun fires, there are gases that are held within the gun tube, and the pressure on the outside of the vehicle is greater than the pressure on the inside of the vehicle. So when you open the breech, that pressure is going to cause the gases to be expelled into the turret of the vehicle. And after a while, you're going to asphyxiate the crew. So you're going to have to open up the hatches to vent the vehicle from the inside. A major step forward in the design of the T-34 was the jump between the 76-millimeter gun version and the 85-millimeter gun version. The 76-millimeter gun, in and of itself, was a pretty good gun. But the 85-millimeter gun is the rough equivalent of the German 75-millimeter gun you find in, say, the Panther tank. So this gun is roughly equivalent. And with that gun, you can take on, at battle ranges, the Germans with a very good success rate. Unlike the American Sherman, where you had to have at least five Shermans to take on one Panther, with the T-34, you could go one-on-one with a Panther and have a very good chance of winning the fight. The production of the T-34 tank is an extraordinary achievement for a country that is basically just industrializing. I mean, the five-year plans that Stalin had during the 30s industrialized to a good deal. The Soviet economy went from basically a peasant economy to an industrial economy almost overnight. So the production of this vehicle is an extraordinary achievement. And not only is it an extraordinary achievement of just being able to do it technologically, which it's a technological marvel in and of itself, but they made in excess of 50,000 of these vehicles. Lenin once said that quantity has a quality all its own. So the Germans turn out 5,000 Panthers. The Russians turn out in excess of 50,000 T-34s. The United States turns out 55,000 Shermans. The Germans got outproduced in addition to being outfought on the Western Front and Eastern Front. During the Battle of Kursk, the Russians know that the Germans are going to attack them. And because they know they're going to be attacked, they adopt a defensive posture. And they, in fact, lure the Germans into fire cauldrons where they actually decimate the Germans in these ambushes, large ambushes. And then once they do that, then they can go back over and use the tank and what it's actually best used for in the attack. So they allow the Germans to attack and then they counterattack using the technical innovations of the T-34 to its best. When the Germans first see these vehicles, they're shocked. They can't believe that these subhumans, the Undermenschen, can have such a vehicle that was actually superior to anything they had at that time. And to a large extent, the development of the Panther was accelerated, and they used a lot of ideas that were in the T-34. For instance, the idea of the sloped armor. That's a direct copy of the T-34 tank. So the Germans were absolutely amazed at the technical innovations that are on this vehicle. During World War II, tanks operate well in open terrain. That is to say, if you don't have a lot of trees, you don't have a lot of villages, and of course, Russia and the Russian front is a wide open expanse, and it is great tank country. It's like operating sort of in the desert. Operating in the desert's great tank country. You can maneuver well. You can use the shock of the tank, the mobility of the tank to good effect. Once you get in closed terrain, you lose that with a tank. Closed terrain meaning things like a forest or a city. During the Battle of Berlin, when the Red Army gets in there, you're going to find that a lot of the fighting is going to be done by mainly three groups of folks, Hitler Youth and the SS, which were fanatical. And those guys were just not going to give up because they knew what was going to happen to them. I mean, they had done the same thing to the Russians going the other way. So the fighting is extraordinarily vicious at close ranges, and in any city fight, it's just terrible. The other group of Germans, of course, the old guys who either regular soldiers or the Volkssturm, who veterans of, say, the First World War, they know what a fight's like, and the veterans of the Eastern Front, they know they're in a losing cause. So they were more likely to give up. But the Hitler Youth, mainly through inexperience, because they just don't know, and the SS, because they're the true believers, they're not going to give up. And the Russians have to go in there and clean them out. One of the vulnerabilities of the T-34 is in a town or close terrain, any kind of close terrain, like a forest. And what happens is these vehicles get channelized down avenues of approach. And because it's not armored all the same, all the way around, it's vulnerable from the sides and the rear and the top. So one of the things the Germans would do would be to wait for the vehicle to go by and shoot it in the back with the Panzerschreck or Panzerfaust, because the armor is thinner in the rear and on the sides. So tanks are extraordinarily vulnerable in towns without infantry support. From, say, the Battle of Kursk on, it would be fair to say that the Soviets have equivalent armor to the Germans. The T-34 is every bit as good as the Panther, and in a lot of respects, it's superior. For instance, the gasoline engine in the Panther is subject to fire. It was a mechanical nightmare to work on the Panther tank. This is a very simple vehicle. the guns are roughly equivalent. So if someone held a gun to my head and forced me to get into a tank in World War II, I'd want to be in the T-34 and not the Panther.